From beginning to end, I'm gonna show you the three steps I took to making up to $550 profit from a single furniture flip. Hey guys, I'm Logan. I'm the furniture flipping entrepreneur. I teach others how to take back their time from jobs by making money flipping furniture. Today, I'm gonna walk you through the process on how to flip furniture for profit. All the details involved can be summed up in three simple to follow steps. You need to find the furniture, fix the furniture, and flip the furniture. I'm gonna show you how I used these three steps on a dresser vanity combo that's gonna set me up for a potential profit of $550. Now, first things first, before I could start working on this piece of furniture, I obviously had to do step number one. I had to find the furniture. I find the majority of my furniture at the same place I sell my furniture. You're gonna go to Facebook Marketplace, go into the search bar, and the three things I search for most commonly are furniture, chairs, and velvet. After you put that into the search term, you're gonna wanna filter your results. I always filter by listed in the last 24 hours, and I also make sure that it's only a local delivery. I don't wanna see any items listed that will be shipped to me, because those are usually items that are lesser quality, drop shipped, or they're coming from a place like China. So I don't wanna deal with anything that's shipped to me. I just wanna find local furniture. Okay, so I found a listing that's attractive to me. It's an old piece of furniture. It looks like it's in relatively good shape, and I think I can get it within my price range. I very rarely go over $80. If it's a sofa and I know I can quickly flip it, sometimes I'll go over 80, but the majority of the time I stay under $80. One of the most important things when looking for furniture is your timing. Undervalued furniture goes really quickly on Facebook Marketplace. That's why we filter for furniture listed within 24 hours, because we want to be one of the first people to talk to the seller. I knew this was a really good value for $80, so right off the bat, I communicated if I can swing by today, and I asked her preferred payment method. So I immediately showed her I was interested in buying, and I'm also available to pick it up really quickly, which is another plus from her perspective. Throughout our whole back and forth messaging, I wanted to make sure I maintained a friendly demeanor. I wanted to make sure she thought I was a nice person, because people are more willing to work with you if they think you're a nice person, especially when it involves you coming into their home. And the last thing to point out here in this message conversation is my constant communication. I want to make sure I arrive on time, and if I know I'm going to be a little late or a little early, I make sure I communicate that and keep them in the know throughout the whole process. You wanna make sure you don't upset the person you're in a transaction with, because then you might get a bad rating, and that's gonna hurt your visibility with selling products in the future. The last thing to note is, if you ever show up to a home and the product is not what you thought it was gonna be, you're always in the clear to say you're not interested and walk away from the deal. But in this case, I loved the way the piece looked. It needed a little bit of work, but I knew with a little bit of elbow grease, I was gonna be able to bring this back to life and sell it for a large profit. And that brings us to step number two. You're gonna need to fix this piece of furniture. When you look at refurbished furniture, you might think it seems like a whole lot of work or it's really complicated, but it's really pretty easy. I'm gonna show you the process I used to fix up this dresser vanity combo. And the cool thing is, I use this exact same process on every piece of wooden furniture I get. I'll be sure to keep a list of this entire process in the description down below. So once I got this dresser into my shop, the first thing I did was remove all of the hardware. For newer furniture, this just requires a Phillips head screwdriver. For older furniture like this dresser that we're working on in this video, you're gonna need a flathead screwdriver. Next, you're gonna look over the piece of furniture and you're gonna patch any holes and make a note of what repairs need to be done. I patched the holes with something called plastic wood. Plastic wood is just like a putty type substance that you can put in the hole, and within like a day, it dries and it takes on the same texture as wood. So when you cover it in paint, you can't tell the difference and you never know that there was a hole there. I'm using my fingers here in this video, but for best results, you probably want to use something like a putty knife. This dresser is dated somewhere from the 1800s, so it's been through a lot. That being said, it is in pretty good condition, but there were repairs that need to be made. For instance, the drawer sliders were a little loose, so I put some screws into the drawer sliders so that they would be more secure. Now, I'm by no means professional. This is clearly not the best look, but it was all that was necessary to make it functional and make the dresser able to be sold, which is the goal in the long run. Other repairs included a piece of wood that broke off the back. So I used wood glue here. Wood glue is great for attaching wood to wood. All you need to do is spray a little bit of the glue, attach the wood, and you need a clamp or something so that it keeps it secure and in place while it's drying. The last repair here, I didn't do until after the sanding, so I'll touch on that in just a second. Next step here is we're gonna sand and wipe down the furniture. You always wanna sand and wipe the surface before you apply paint or a sealer or any kind of finish. So now the last repair I need to make on this dresser is it was missing its backing. So what I did is I went to Home Depot and I purchased something called, I went to Home Depot and purchased wood board. And I was looking for something strong enough to act like wood, but thin enough that I could cut with something like my utility knife. I'm cutting it with my utility knife because I don't have anything like a skill saw or a circular saw, which would have been ideal in this situation, but you gotta make do with what you have. And I don't wanna spend a lot of money when I'm trying to make money. So I scored the lines with a utility knife. And then once those lines were scored, then I just dug in again and again and again, and eventually I cut through. And the lines were good enough for what I needed. Once I inserted the wood board into the back of the dresser, I nailed it in place with some small nails I had, and then I was ready for the first layer of paint. With painting, I used a 4-inch roller, and I also used a brush for the finer details and corners. After my first layer of paint, I once again sanded the piece, and I wiped clean the debris and the dust left over after the sanding to get ready for the second layer of paint. Okay, so now I have the piece of furniture fully painted. It's starting to come together, it's starting to look pretty nice, but I'm gonna need to seal the piece of furniture because if you just put paint on, you'll learn, as I did, that it chips really easily. So if you're trying to put in your truck, if you're trying to deliver it somewhere, it's gonna chip and the buyer won't like that so much. So best practice is to always seal the furniture after you paint it. And I did this with something called polyurethane. It's a seal that you can brush on and it just adds a protective coating on top of the paint so you can't scratch the paint off. Once I covered the dresser and the vanity with the polyurethane, I once again sanded it and wiped all of the sanding dust off. On parts of the furniture that get rubbed a lot, I'll make sure to add an extra layer of the polyurethane so it's protected over time. Now we're almost done. All that's left is the hardware. For the hardware, I'm gonna sand it down until it's smooth, and then I'm gonna spray it with spray paint, wait for it to dry, and then apply a coat of seal, and I have a spray paint seal as well. And there you have it. That's the entire process. Okay, so now comes the fun part. The part where we list the dresser online and sell it to make a profit. Step number 3 is we have to flip the piece of furniture. If we wanna see that profit, we're gonna have to get this online and get it sold to a buyer. It sounds so simple, but this is all I do. The same place I bought the piece of furniture off, Facebook Marketplace, I'll list on Facebook Marketplace, and I use a very specific formula with every single one of my listings. I always give a descriptive title with one adjective that encapsulates the feeling of that piece of furniture. I went a little basic with this piece of furniture, but the first thing that popped in my head was beautiful, so I went with beautiful. Now, this might seem like a very small detail, but you'd be surprised how many buyers have used the same adjective when describing that piece of furniture once I meet them in person. For instance, there's been a time when I described a piece of furniture as cute, and also another time when I described it as fun, and both times the buyer used that same verbiage when describing the furniture to me, which tells me they were paying attention to the description either subconsciously or consciously. So make sure you add that adjective. Now, for the first paragraph after the title, I always try to express the feeling of the piece of furniture. It's more powerful to express the idea of the furniture instead of describing all of its specifications. You can see I did this here by beginning the paragraph with this reference to Harry Potter in Diagon Alley. For the second paragraph, you always want to describe the condition of the piece of furniture. You want to be as clear as possible about the description so there's no surprises when the buyer comes in contact with the furniture for the first time. It'll save you a lot of headache if you're honest up front. That being said, I do always try my best to put a positive spin on the flaw of the furniture. the largest flaw with the dresser is the tarnished mirror. So what I did is I made a joke, again referencing Harry Potter, with the intention to infuse a little bit of humor into the post and kind of deflect from the flaw. For the next paragraph, which is more of like a sentence, I always have the dimensions. The dimensions are really important because people are usually trying to fill a specific space in their room, and if you don't give the dimensions up front, they might just pass over your post because it's too much trouble to reach out and ask for the dimensions. So it's always important to include the length, width, and height in inches. I always mention I'll deliver for free within the bounds of my city. Now this is huge because furniture is big and bulky, and the majority of people don't have a truck to come pick up that piece of furniture. So if you offer free delivery, it greatly increases your amount of potential buyers. Now if you don't have a truck and you can't deliver it yourself, be sure to check out my last video where I mention a really cool hack to get around this. And the last thing I'll add is a call to action. I almost always use this call to action. I just tell them to reach out with any questions or offers. What this does is it tells the potential buyer how to reach out to you, and it also hints that you might be a little flexible with the price, which could entice them to reach out when otherwise they wouldn't. Okay guys, my dresser has been listed for less than 12 hours, so it hasn't sold yet, but it has already started getting some bites. Sometimes you'll sell a piece in an hour, and other times it could take you a whole month to sell a piece of furniture. For example, today I sold a purple velvet sofa that I've had listed on Facebook for over 1 month. I bought this sofa for $65, and its only flaw being one loose leg, which I simply fixed with some wood glue. And today it sold for $450. An example closer to the dresser that was in this case study was another black dresser that I sold last week. I bought that black dresser for $60, again staying within my $80 budget, and I sold it for $500 using the exact same process I just shared with you. Okay, so now you know the 3 steps to make money flipping furniture. If you guys found this helpful, be sure to subscribe and turn on your notification bell. Then you won't miss my future videos posted every Sunday about making money flipping furniture. If this video helps you make your first furniture flip, let me know down in the comments below. I need like a, how do people say goodbye in YouTube videos? Like, all right, bye. Or they just end it. Deuces.